It is now time for me, it is a privilege for me to invite Shri Nandan Nilekani to give his keynote address on what is his perspective on open network for digital commerce. Mr. Nandan Nilekani, please.
Thank you, Anil ji, and it's really a terrific pleasure and privilege to be here at this ONDC event as part of the Startup Innovation Week that DPIIT is organizing. I am really excited to be here. I'm a member of the Advisory Council along with other distinguished members, and I really believe ONDC is an idea whose time has come. To give you some background, I thought I'll speak about how India has always been a leader in digital transformation at population scale. India has been on this journey of digital transformation at population scale for a decade now. And huge parts of our economy and social activity have been transformed by technology. One example is, of course, Aadhaar, which has reached 1.3 billion people, which is at the foundational identity for all Indians. Today, the Aadhaar system, which is designed at population scale for high volume, low cost transaction, does 50 million authentications a day and 5 million eKYCs a day, and is at the root of many, many foundation for many, many other applications. For example, India runs the world's largest DBT program, where 700 million people have Aadhaar-linked bank accounts. Our secretary, Anurag Jain, was the joint secretary in the Department of Financial Services in the days when they rolled out the Jan Dhan program. So he knows, and he's been a key instrument in that transformation. And thanks to the fact that we have 700 million Aadhaar-linked bank accounts and the Jan Dhan bank account opening initiative, India runs the world's largest digital benefit transfer system in the world, the DBT, where few hundred thousand crores have moved effortlessly, automatically, in real time, into people's bank accounts. This is, again, the kind of technology that India has built. And it is not just about crediting the money into the bank accounts. India also has a unique system called the Aadhaar-enabled payment system, which allows millions of people to withdraw money from their bank account in the safety and convenience of their village. They can go to a business correspondent. We have several few hundred thousand business correspondents in India today. Go to a neighborhood Kirana store, just put their finger on the device, withdraw money, and the Kirana store will hand over money to the customer from their bank account and debit their account and credit the Kirana's account. And this system does 90 million transactions a month of 25,000 crores. That means 25,000 crores is being withdrawn by people around the country effortlessly, thanks to the digital rails that India has laid. Then, of course, we have something which we all talk about, which is UPI, the Unified Payment Interface. And many of the ideas we have in ONDC are modeled on the success of UPI. UPI, again, was a system designed by NPCI, which has been at the forefront of payment transformation in India. UPI was conceived about 8 years back. The first launch of UPI happened in February of 2016. And then there was a final launch of the product, February 2015. And finally, in May 2016, we had the launch of UPI. And UPI was designed to be a next generation payment system, which gave complete interoperability between banks and digital platforms and allowed for all kinds of innovation to come. And in October of 2016, this platform was only doing 100,000 transactions. And then in November of 2016, when the government chose to do the demonetization, the withdrawal of certain currencies, the government chose to take UPI as the flagship platform along with RuPay for digital transformation and digital payments. The Prime Minister himself launched the Bheem application, which was a very simple user-oriented application for people to do payments on the phone. And now UPI Bheem, as it is called, has become a world leader. And last month alone did 4.5 billion transactions valued at more than $100 billion. And therefore, it's again a great example of success in payments and so on. And then there are many other platforms. India has a common platform for taxes, for indirect taxes through GST, a common platform for direct taxes. And also another important thing is the account aggregator platform, which has been sponsored and led by the RBI, which is fundamentally going to transform credit to small businesses, because now they can use their digital footprint and access credit by using the data from many systems, giving it in a secure manner to a lender who will then decide to give them a loan. So we are now with the AA launch, which happened in September of last year. We are now, India is now building the infrastructure for democratizing credit at population scale, both for consumers as well as for small businesses. Another example of our population scale systems, which is not that well recognized, is FASTag. FASTag is the system used by our travelers on our highways to automatically pay the toll when they drive through a toll gate. This system has had a huge productivity benefit for the economy. So when a truck is going from Kashmir to Kanyakumari, it can just drive through the toll gate, and automatically the toll is deducted from the bank account or wallet attached to the RFID tag, which is on the truck. And this system has been, again, a spectacular success. And today this system is doing a few hundred million transactions. And the daily collection on FASTag is 100 crores. So something like 40,000 crores a year is the annual collection of toll money. This has made our road infrastructure more viable. It has allowed the government to monetize these assets and recycle the capital into new road building. And therefore, it's again an example of the use of technology. And the RFID tag-based system has got is really a platform again, and it can be used for other applications. I recently noticed that there is a startup that has been funded, which will do parking charges using RFID tags. So which means that in the parking lot, you just drive in, and based on the number of hours you park in the parking lot and what time of the day it is dynamically calculates the parking charge and you will get debited. And this has been a well-funded startup. So all these things are happening. And then there are many, many other examples. There's the Ayushman Bharat Digital Mission, which has been launched. It is being led by the National Health Authority. Another advisory council member, Ram Sevak Sharma, leads that. And this is going to transform healthcare by enabling a unified health interface, just like a unified payment interface, which allows all these, all the different health providers to interoperate seamlessly. Again, the Ayushman Bharat Digital Health Mission has been launched by the Prime Minister, and a lot of work is going on to make a change there. And then there are many, many other examples of these kind of large-scale systems and platforms that India has built. And these platforms are designed at population scale. These platforms are designed for very high volume, billions of transactions, designed for low or no cost, and designed for a small sachet size. So they're very, very inclusive systems that have been designed. Now, why is it that India has been so successful in making these platforms happen? The reason is because many, many things have come together. The first, of course, is there has been a tremendous government commitment to using technology for development. The Prime Minister has talked about TechAid, or this being the technology decade. And he is the first to ask why technology is not being used for solving a particular problem. And in every one of these initiatives, we have had extremely high government support. Aadhaar took off because there was great support from governments. When Prime Minister Modi came in 2014, I met him and he was very supportive of Aadhaar. He has become a huge champion, and that continues. And in the case of NPCI, again, in November of 2016, after the withdrawal of certain currency notes, there was a big push, which, as I said, which is why the transactions went up from 100,000 to 4.5 billion in about 5 years. And this government support is there everywhere. In the case of FASTag, there's tremendous support from the minister, Mr. Gadkari, so on. So wherever there is one fundamental requirement to make all these large-scale systems work is government commitment from both government and from the bureaucracy who are part of that. So I think that is something which is there. The second thing is it has to address a market or social need. In the case of UPI, India needed a low-cost transaction platform so that somebody on the street selling vegetables from a cart should be able to make payments. In the case of Aadhaar, we had to solve the problem of millions of Indians not having identity, and as they started migrating, being unable to prove who they are, whether it was to board a train or bus or to get a job. For FASTag, the reason was that there was a lot of leakage of money at the highways, and people were not paying, and therefore a lot of infrastructure projects that had been privatized, the investors were not getting a return on that. For GST, it was because India wanted to have a single market. Earlier, we had every country, every state had its own sales tax or VAT system, and GST created a single market and unified the tax platform. For health, we have had the need to provide large-scale insurance through Ayushman Bharat, and now we want, and the pandemic has shown the need for health. We saw the vaccination drive. One part of the vaccination success, obviously, was the fact that India has great vaccine manufacturing companies like Serum and Bharat Bio and others. The other part is that we built an extraordinary platform like Cowin, which has allowed everybody in the country to register and get their vaccination. And there is the DIVOC vaccination certificate. So recently, there was a friend of mine from Chicago who came to Bombay, and the security guard at the hotel asked him to show his vaccination certificate. And he showed them a piece of paper. And the security guard said, "Yeah, aapke paas digital nahi hai kya?" So that is the level of reach that we have, where even the security guard has understood that we have a digital vaccination certificate with a QR code. So there has to be a market or social need. The third important requirement is there has to be a technology which is there and built. So in every one of these cases, there's some amazing technology which has been built. It's been built at population scale. It's been built using the latest techniques of open source and the latest developments of AI and so on. In fact, one of the biggest use of AI is actually Aadhaar, where the authentication is using AI. So India has built all that. In the case of UPI, again, entirely built on an open source stack by NPCI. And NPCI is, again, a very forward-looking organization. And now they're using the UPI stack for other. So all the other payment systems in NPCI, like AEPS or IMPS, all sit on top of the same software stack. So these are all very, very sophisticated, high-end things. We have people like Dr. Pramod Verma, who has been working for the country for the last 10 years in designing these architectures and so on. So you require world-class technology. Then you need institutions for implementation. For Aadhaar, we had the UIDAI, which has had a series of amazing IAS officers as the CEOs. For NPCI, we have had the extraordinary company. NPCI started by RBI with a dynamic CEO in Mr. Dilip Basbe. For For the AA system, we have a great support from the Reserve Bank of India, which has taken this as a very important step forward, and so on. So institutions are required to actually execute on this. Institutions either which are independent or within the government, like Anurag drove the Jan Dhan program when he was at DFS. And then you need to develop systems in a way where the government provides or enables infrastructure, but innovators can sit on top of it and build great applications. And that is what we are seeing today. Banks, for example, new payment banks have come up, new private banks have come up. They're all using Aadhaar, eKYC and all that. When Reliance launched Jio, they were able to ramp up to 100 million users on the Jio platform, in part because they used Aadhaar eKYC to do the KYC for giving the mobile connections. So it has enabled innovation in many ways. I talked about the company that has come up for parking in payments. We have seen a massive explosion of fintech companies, all of whom are sitting on top of this infrastructure that we have. So we need to have the innovators, and that becomes very important. So therefore, if any idea which is of this type has to succeed, it has to satisfy these four or five things. It needs to have strong government commitment. It needs to address a market and social need. It needs to have world-class technology. It needs to have an institution to anchor and promote this. And it needs dynamic innovators to embrace it. All these things are required to make it a success. Now, where does ONDC fit in this? I believe the Open Network for Digital Commerce meets all the criteria for the next revolution and disruption in India. First, we have dynamic government commitment. We have seen terrific commitment from the minister, Mr. Piyush Goyal, whom I have known very well for his dynamism and entrepreneurial energy. And he has been at the forefront of making this happen. We have people like Anurag Jain, who is a veteran of technology transformation in Madhya Pradesh. He led the creation of the earliest CSCs 15 years back when I first met him. He had implemented the first CSCs in Madhya Pradesh. We have Anil Agarwal as the AS, whose response is faster than anyone I've met in the private sector. You call him up and he replies within 1 minute. So this is amazing. So there's amazing energy in the system. And then we have people like my friend Adil Zainulbai, who as heading the QCI is playing a big role. And he comes again, he's an old friend and from my days at IIT Bombay and McKinsey, and now helping the government on QCI. So we have a fantastic commitment from the government, and I know the Prime Minister's office themselves care deeply about this. So first requirement is we have the government commitment. The second requirement is a market and social need. Now this has become very, very important because especially the pandemic has demonstrated that e-commerce is going to be a way of life for Indians. So we are going to see in the coming years a massive migration of more and more people ordering online through their devices. There'll be more devices, there'll be more accessible devices, there'll be millions of people using that, and there will be more ordering of online. India has a trillion dollar retail economy. And even if 10 to 20% of that goes online, we are talking about $100 to $200 billion doing online. Now, e-commerce is not a winner-take-all economy. It is not about, unlike advertising, unlike social media or search and those kind of areas where you have one or two players have all the action. In the case of e-commerce, there will be multiple players, and we have to create a way for the small entrepreneur, the small merchant, the small seller to compete in this new e-commerce world in equitable ways. So if we are going to increase the proportion of e-commerce to total commerce to even 20% of our retail business, we're talking about $200 billion, And therefore, we owe it to our millions of sellers and millions of small retailers to give them an easy way to participate in this new emerging high growth digital commerce. So there's a huge market and social need for this. The third thing is that we need an institution, and the system has been very farsighted in setting up the ONDC as a company, a nonprofit Section 8 company, very similar to NPCI, which is a nonprofit Section 8 company owned by banks, and now it's owned by actually more than banks. And ONDC also will have a large number of public-spirited shareholders. And I'm told that there's enormous interest in investing in NPCI, in ONDC. So ONDC will act as the nonprofit public-spirited institution that will orchestrate the interactions of this new ONDC, this open network, and put in place the ground rules, the network participant rules, the obligations, the counterparty rules, how to deal with complaints, dispute resolution, and so on. So somebody has to perform that role, and the ONDC will support that role. It's very important to realize that this is something which requires a great technology. I said in every one of our earlier successful things in India, technology has been at the root of it. And I'm aware that the technology platform is really, it's more protocols. It's not even technology, it's protocols. And the protocols that are being designed for ONDC are best in class and will allow a wide set of network participants to interoperate and contribute, where different sellers can participate and reach different buyers. Different buyers can reach different sellers. So discovery is done through this interoperability. And this is something which, so it will have top class protocols and so on. And it will have, it has the advantage of a well thought through advisory council. I mentioned my friend Adil. Adil is a member of that. Dilip Asbe, who led NPCI, is a member of that. Mr. Ram Sevak Sharma, the CEO of NHA, is a member of that. I'm a member of that. Anjali Bansal is a member of that. Rajgopal is a member of that. The CAIT person, Mr. Khandelwal, is there. So it's a very, very good, of course, we have the officials. So it's a very, very good group of people. We have Arvind Gupta, who's also been a leader in this space. So we have a lot of people who've done this before. So these are not people who are just theoreticians. These are people who are practitioners who have actually built some of the systems that we have. We have Koshi as an advisor. Koshi has been building population system for 30 years. He was part of the first team which built India's dematerialized NSDL, as well as the National Pension System. So really all the people who over the years have participated in this are part of this. So that's also very important. And then, of course, we will want to have the market participants. And I believe that this is going to be fundamental to the market participants. And I really hope that all the market participants will realize that here's something where the need is very large, where government is committed, where there's an institution to make it happen, where there are technology leaders who have done this before, where there is great technology. All of these things are coming together. And therefore, I would urge all market innovators to be part of that. We have already seen the tremendous response that the hackathon got. I just saw the exciting thing, and you know, two 15-year-olds or 13-year-olds are building apps. That is the future of India, and I think we are showing the way there. Now, why is this going to be so important? Basically, because there are four or five mega trends that are shaping this thing. First, as I mentioned earlier, and the pandemic has only accelerated that, is movement from offline to online commerce. And if you only get 20% of $1 trillion, that's $200 billion of retail. So the movement from offline to online. The second is the movement from the Western model of advertising-led internet to the Indian model of transaction-led internet. In the West, the last 20 years, the rise of the internet was fueled by digital advertising. That's how the big players like Google and Facebook make money, because advertising in the US was a few hundred billion dollar revenue, which started migrating to digital. That's how they were able to make money. But in India, the digital advertising is very small. It's only $2 to $3 billion out of the total $10 billion advertising revenue of India. And therefore, India will be a transaction-led economy for internet. And things like UPI, which is very high volume, zero cost, very simple to use, will drive that. And therefore, we have to take advantage of the fact that India will be a transaction-led internet economy. And that is also part of the trend that ONDC will play on. The third is the movement of customers from department store to doorstep, where people have got used to, especially in the pandemic, to get delivery home. And delivery home is not just about big platforms delivering it to home. Every retail kirana store has a home delivery. You can pick up the phone and call up the guy and he'll have it delivered to you at home. So delivery at home is now become ubiquitous everywhere. And then a very big move that is happening is India is going from unbranded to branded. So what we're seeing is we are going to see the rise of a lot more brands in every part, whether it's you'll have branded rice, you'll have branded soap, you'll have branded face cream. So you're going to see massive brands, and all of them will want access to consumers, and all of them will work with creators and all to, you know, create the story on their products. So this massive branding is going to happen, and every one of those new brands will want access to the market. The fourth is the modernization of India's small traders. I think we have millions of small traders, and thanks to technology, thanks to startups, thanks to GST, they're doing everything digitally now, and they are now ready for participating in this ecosystem. And finally, India's transition from prepaid to postpaid. The mobile revolution of India happened thanks to prepaid phones. The big genius of the telecom companies was they came up with a way to get millions of subscribers and got them to pay in advance, 5 rupees, 10 rupees to get mobile talk time. But now with account aggregator, OKN, and all these other platforms, credit at scale is going to happen. And therefore, both the consumers who are going to be buyers on the system through things like buy now, pay later kind of credit, or the suppliers who will get access to supply credit using the account aggregator system and leveraging the OKN protocol, suddenly India will go from next 10 years from prepaid to postpaid. And all this means that everybody has a chance. The suppliers who are producing products will get access to a whole new set of consumers through the ONDC. The small retailer can participate on an equal footing in ONDC. And if he sees a particular request for a product, he can say, look, I just live 500 meters from your house, I will deliver it to you. And therefore, the small retailer, the kirana store, can participate in the retail transaction and get things delivered. A whole set of delivery companies will come up, who will specialize in becoming efficient deliverers, quick commerce, this, that. There'll be a huge number of interfaces. People will be able to use voice. They'll be able to speak in Indian languages. They'll be able to do all kinds of things so that it'll become easy for the Indian to access this e-commerce platform. And those innovations will happen independent of the supply chain. And then you'll see brand aggregators coming. We are seeing many new brand aggregators, Mensa brands and many others, Global Bees and so on. And they're going to aggregate brands and they will want access to consumers. So all these things are happening today. And this will lead to a massive explosion enabled by ONDC. So I just want to make it clear that number one, ONDC will happen. The conditions are there, the right people are there, the government commitment is there. We will make it happen. It is a unified effort of government, public-spirited individuals, and the market. Not only it will happen fast. It took us 9-10 years to get 1 billion people to Aadhaar. It took us 5 years from launch to get UPI to 4 billion. But ONDC will happen much faster because we know the journey. We know how to make this happen. We know how to sequence the tasks. We know how to create the coalitions. We know how to create the incentives. And therefore, we will do it faster than any other transformation that we have done. ONDC will expand the market. It is not about creating an alternative. It is about expanding the market. It is about allowing more suppliers, more consumers, and more merchants and more delivery companies all to participate. And therefore, it is going to expand the market dramatically so that more and more people can this thing. Early adopters will benefit. It is important. I remember when I used to talk to my friends in the banking sector in 2015, 2016, saying your business is going to change dramatically. They were not very convinced. And now they all say, I wish I had listened to you earlier. So this is going to happen very quickly before people know what's happening. And therefore, those who embrace it. So I really would recommend that everybody get on board now and participate in the most exciting business transformation happening in the world. Thank you very much and all the best for ONDC. Thank you all.